try to continue with the next session. The next session has two cases from Latin America. One case is a case of the early childhood longitudinal survey of Chile. And I would like to welcome Dr. Bravo to talk about this very interesting study that shows that, yes, we can do longitudinal studies in Latin America. Where is the link here?
Thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation. I'm going to put myself over here because when I started my first doing a study in 2002, when I was presenting my results, I was able to, at that time, I was able to read. Now I need this in bigger. Okay. So the I'm going to talk about the early childhood longitudinal survey, what we call the encuesta longitudinal de la primera infancia in Chile. Some of the motivations we use to promote the survey from the point of view of policy and from the point of view of problems in Chile. And I will discuss pretty much about the characteristics of the survey and then some of the results. So I will need you, Alfonso, maybe if you could let me know after 20 minutes, so I could give room for questions. Okay, so first thing, of course, very common in our countries. We have high inequality, as more development, we would like to go the right direction. When one looks at the gaps in socioeconomic, here we are looking at this fourth grade, and these are the differences in educational achievement in tests. So what we have here is the standard deviation. So in first grade we have pretty much one something standard deviation. Then when we continue measuring and different eighth grade, 10th grade, and then this is with some before entering university. So the gap is a bit higher here. And when we follow people over the labor market, these gaps pretty much stay. So we realize we don't have any information over here. So we use that gap to promote the fact that we need some measure just to understand what are the origins of this inequality. At the same time, we're looking at our research agenda, and of course, we used the fact that there was a tremendous push from international evidence on the positive effect of early childhood development interventions. And we realized that there were a lot of limitations of the available studies. Typically, these studies were done for small samples, internationally representative, using static models. The problem is very limited in scale. Of course, the problem is trying to determine causality. A few studies looking at cost benefit analysis. So, what we, at that time, I'm talking about. 2008. So we organized a seminar to we identified two or three components that were very important to move forward this research and public policy agenda. We started with data. We said that we need a very well designed collection of data. But not only data, we need also some presentations and, of course, always in the identification strategy. We also use this idea of looking at the whole life cycle from conception, yes, birth, childhood, adolescence, adulthood, old age, as a continuum that is course of interest for all of us. And it's very also, it's an effort, it's a very interdisciplinary effort because, of course, we need to put together to work, to analyze individuals, families, people along this lifestyle. So, in the case of Chile, there were some policies that were also helped to us. President Bachelet's first term in 2006 promoted early childhood development projects. Mostly the coverage by public providers, Salatuna, but at the same time, a policy, a national ECD policy that Chile has a team that try to integrate health and education. Given that this was very important, so we, of course, start discussing how we would evaluate this course. And then we went back to our table where we had this components of the year. So at the end, it seems that we were successful on trying to make the point. Here is, for example, how the enrollment by year is schoolers, nurseries, infantile, 4 years, 5 years old, this is pre-K, and this is kindergarten, and how this coverage has been increasing over time. This has been part of the policy. This is the richest peak time. And we have 2013 and that on our. Okay, so this is our survey. We designed it in 2008, 2009. The key was the support by the Ministerio de Hacienda. The first round was applied in 2010. And the second round was applied in 2012. Maybe more detail here. First thing was our first round was applied in 2010 and was funded by the Ministry of Education. It's very funny. However, in the second round, we moved to the Ministry of Labor, which is not that completely logical. But at that time, there were a lot of pressures on education, federal education, and other nations in the streets. So higher education was taking the lead for resources and everything. So we went to the Ministry of Labor. At that time, there was a law, I don't remember exactly. No one says this in English, but this was natal permiso.
Parental leave.
Okay.
Parental leave.
The parental leave, right? So it was increased, this parental leave, from 3 to 6 months. And the Secretary of Labor at that time was leading the policy. So when we realized that we were not going to be second round of education. So we moved to the few blocks away, and we start talking about evaluating the policy. And that worked out very good. So we got the funding, we got our second. So for example, in figures, the LP 2010, two important things. We took a sample out of the registry of births. So we used the whole census of births. We took all the births from January 2006, in August 31st, 2009, and then we took a sample. 15,000 individuals. The good thing, the important thing about this is that from the beginning we got the IDs, the numbers, social security numbers. In Chile we call them roots. So not only that, but also we request a lot of information. So I don't know if I can tell you here, nobody from Chile here. So we request a lot of information from at that level. So we got the IDs of the mother, the father, the biological father, brothers and sisters, all much. From there we received also the addresses. And then we went to the field. In 2012, we added the births until 2011. Finally, we ran 15,100 surveys, and we're going to talk about the instruments, also the evaluation instruments we use. At the beginning, we were thinking on the design. We were reading a lot on different alternatives, and I remember we discussed this cohort study that is used in UK, is very famous, where you go and survey all people born in a specific day. We prefer this design, so to have more variation along. So we have birth distributed a long time. 2012, we added a few other individuals, and we have in total 18,000 children. The oldest one were born in January 2006, so we are going to be in the field again in 2016. So they're going to be probably 9 years old. And the youngest were born in 2011. So now our survey is mutating to something that is not explicitly an early child sample. So what we have is we try to measure development of children. Areas, some difficulties. We go and apply a questionnaire. A questionnaire is applied to mothers, 8% of the cases. The person in charge. The individual that was selected randomly was the child. And so we look for we apply a questionnaire. In a second visit, we send a psychologist who applies some of the tests. And at the end of the first visit, he asks the mother to sign the consent for going to the second visit. Of course, in the first visit, there is a consent. Okay, so let me just skip this stuff. The household survey, we designed household survey to include things about questions about household composition, household information, each member's education, healthcare status, labor participation status. Some information about the different models of the questionnaire. But it's something like this. So, education, employment status. This is the only part that regards the whole group. And then we go to basic information about the mother or in relation to the child. Social protection, some information on assets. Of course, we have information about how was the pregnancy, so we have a lot of questions on the mother's pregnancy. Also on the participation, about the participation in different programs, like the children's activity and other courses. Child care participation, women, and some questions about the biological. In some cases, they live in the house, not other figures, other people who purchase. In 2012, I guess, we added some additional things, like more explicitly, immunization history, some labor history also from mothers, a model on habits, life at home, say for example, how the domestic work is distributed in the household. In 2010, we had a big earthquake in Chile, so we also included some questions about the earthquake. Just to, we were thinking on trying to take advantage of the that, so we wanted to know exactly where they were. So yeah, this is pretty much typically what one would include in a questionnaire. But the main thing is, of course, adding evaluations. We are interested in evaluating children, also mothers. And children, we are including, I mean, we focus on national general development, social emotional development, physical development, and also for mothers, and some characteristics of the household. Some come from the near, some others no. So this is pretty much the list of instruments we apply. Just to let you know, this is 1 hour. We train a lot on this. I mean, we prepare a lot of the work, the field work, because it's very important how this is done. We run several pilots before going into this. Every psychologist also has to receive training on how to apply this. This is a, you know, Chile is very long. So we have to apply simultaneously in different cities, regions. So we need to have people very well prepared and to reduce the heterogeneity, possible heterogeneity mistakes right in the application. So it's a lot of preparation. So here we have what we applied in 2010, here in 2012. So you can see that there are some overlaps, of course, because we want to do that. The choice of the instrument, of course, is very it's very important to discuss. In this case, for example, we use this for general development, these two tests that were not, these were not internationally known, But where applied in the most of the consultorios, health centers. So we use them because it provided information, additional information, but we didn't apply them in 2012. We changed for others. This is the Batemi test. In 2010, we applied the complete version. Here we applied an executive version. And then we applied the Peabody vocabulary test, which is more known internationally. And then we have on the social emotional side, we have the ASQ, the CBCL. This is our children. In 2012, we added some tests to measure self-regulation and executive function. And then we always measure weight. This is the, of course, the other complication is that not every test is designed for everybody, so you have to apply very well. It's very complicated. It's a lot of tasks. And we use tablets, so this helps a lot people to go. They don't have to think much. They have to rightly introduce the right characteristics of the children at the beginning. And then we have mothers. We apply on the social emotional side, the big five inventory, the parent stress index, postnatal depression scale. Probably for the next round, we will innovate here also some other things. Some quick cognitive tests, and we also measure mothers. So this is pretty much what we have done. Yes, that is important. This one. So the important thing is this. We conceive this study as a system of information. So we have the survey, 2010, 2012. And 2016 will be the third, and then we have a plan in 2025. So it's going to be every 3 years, 2019, 2022, 2025. But the most important thing is the linkage. So we have the linkage with administrative records, and now we are just ready to have annual data on these children. So we have, for example, things like attendance, every year's attendance in schools, grades, of course, when they get one of these standardized achievement tests, we have also the scores. So now start the good thing. The good thing is, I mean, we were able to measure this between 0 and 5 years old. And now we're gonna independently, of course, we're gonna have some surveys here, but we're gonna put full records. Of course, we are also following mothers. We already linked with the labor history of mothers coming from such as records too.
Registros de salud.
So yes, in 1 minute, so we have, for example, when we look at,
por ejemplo, cuando vemos al peso y a la,
we didn't see any difference between the first and the fifth quintile. At least we don't have very much problem there. And the motivation and things like that. 1 minute exactly, right? So, and then we got this, 1.1 indexes. And here we have, for example, the PATEL, the PEL, the social emotional, the this is months, 6 months. And we can see that this is the poorest quintile and this is the richest. And we can see how this start to work. This is the Peabody test in image. And this is standard deviations. So just let me give you a final picture. Putting together the same. And then you can see difference between girls and boys. Girls better than boys in this is Patel, for example. Of course, the size of the difference is very different compared to the socioeconomic. Okay, so summarizing, this is, for example, this is the socioeconomic, this is the cognitive test, the cognitive status of mothers. And this is the socio-emotional index of mothers. And this is the TEPSI, one of the general development tests. So you can see that mothers with higher cognitive or higher socio-emotional and both together are very correlated. Is what we see. We also have to include these kind of things in our equations. Just looking at sizes. I think this works a lot because people was very used to look at the gap, looking at universities, when people take the test to go to the university. And every time the test is taken, this is the headline. Headline is, 150 points, which is 110 is one standard deviation. So this is 5.3 standard deviations. And people is very used to that figure. And they look at the next result as if probably this would disappear, but of course, always the same, pretty much. This is the fourth grade test, 125 points. This is the P-value test. The P-value is our test, but around 6 years old. This is in 3 years. And this is at the beginning, when we are able to measure at the beginning, 10 months old. So we can see a huge increase within this period. And of course, when people has detected the problem around over here, because the children were measured here in fourth grade, maybe it's too late, right? Because everything is happening over here. Okay, so I stop here. Let's see if you have any questions.
I would say that we